So thanks everyone for coming. We're going to talk today about the emerging role of the CPSO. So just a brief overview, we're going to talk about what it is, how it's different from your traditional C-suite security roles, why there's a need for it, what it actually is, what makes somebody good at this role, and then conclusion. So I want to just start by level setting and just giving credit where credit is due. CISOs and CISOs are invaluable. They're absolutely fantastic at handling cybersecurity risk as it pertains to enterprise. But they are not one-man shows. Expecting a CISO or a CISO to also handle all facets of cybersecurity is also doomed to fail. So what I'm proposing is that product security is an entirely different beast than enterprise security. And in my mind, asking people like CISOs and CISOs, no matter how talented they are, to also handle product security is like asking a neurosurgeon to also perform a knee surgery. At the end of the day, there's a reason that surgeons go to specialized training for years, because surgery isn't just surgery, it matters what you're operating on. And cybersecurity isn't just cybersecurity, it matters what you're trying to secure. They are different specialties. So setting the stage a little bit. So the FDA announces the first ever recall of a medical device due to cybersecurity risk. So this was precedent setting at its time. It was the first time the FDA had ever actually recalled a medical device for a vulnerability. Now understand that recalls of medical devices are used when a medical device is at the point where the risk to patient safety is at an unacceptable level. So the device has to be recalled. So what happened here? Why did it get to this point? Well, the background here was a cybersecurity researcher found some vulnerabilities in a medical device and tried for about a year and a half to work with or notify the manufacturer. They got varying levels of the cold shoulder and dismissal. So after about a year and a half, the researcher decided to involve regulators. And from then, the regulators produced a recall. It escalated, and it turned into a very bad media spotlight for this company. So the need for product security. Hopefully this comes as no surprise, but at the end of the day, the cold hard truth is, if you are a for-profit company, your product sales is how you make revenue. If you are not making revenue, then you're not going to be a company for very long. Loss of trust in your product can erode your business overnight. There's this neat emerging field in litigation, which is product-specific cybersecurity liability. So people are familiar with cybersecurity risk from enterprise perspective, but product-specific liability litigation is actually kind of ongoing. And we're gonna see over the next couple of years, a lot of precedents get set in this area. But another one is customers are starting to add product security requirements to purchasing contracts. So when I work with various CISOs, what I often like to ask them is what keeps them up at night. One of the most common answers I hear is the risk of the third-party components that they have in their networks and their infrastructure. So flipping that on its head, CISOs are right to be kept up at night by that third-party risk. But flip that around, as a company that makes a product, you are that third-party risk. You are your product is the thing that is keeping other CISOs up at night. And to help manage that, they're starting to add these product security specific clauses into purchase contracts, putting the liability back on you, putting in indemnification clauses, putting in requirements around what you're going to do for patching. They're starting to handle that risk by putting the burden in a legal way back on you. So cybersecurity breaches represent one of the biggest monetary and reputational risks that a company can really face. Everybody knows they're extremely expensive. But what I'm also proposing is that companies focus a tremendous amount on their internal infrastructure, and they're worried about protecting breaches of their internal infrastructure, but I don't see a tremendous amount of scrutiny or spending get spent on the product security. Now, I'm not trying to downplay security breaches. I'm saying they actually get the right amount of scrutiny. But what I am saying is product security should be getting the same level of scrutiny as your internal security. So that's where the Chief Product Security Officer comes in. So the CPSO, his entire domain is to oversee the cybersecurity risk of the products that your company produce. Anything that contains software, It contains firmware. Maybe it's an embedded system. It's an IoT device. At the end of the day, if it is running code and your company is putting its stamp on it, then it's your product and you need to be worried about the cybersecurity of it. Their goal was to implement and oversee product security programs to help manage that business risk created by those products. So what's the CPSO responsible for? So they're responsible at a high level for secure product design. Our goal is to make a more secure product. The cybersecurity risk management of that. Cyber is never done. You can never make a secure device. No such thing exists. So it's always a risk management game of trying to manage the risk that is there. Vulnerability management, incident response, policies and procedures and standards. So peeling that back one layer, I want to show how complicated this can get. Product security is not a feature that you can simply add on. I work with a lot of companies who they're in their maturity cycle and they sort of ask you to just add security onto a product. That's really not possible. Security is not a feature. Security is an emergent property of a well-designed system. So what you get is that if you are doing product security correctly, it affects every stage of the product's development lifecycle. And at every stage, there are different things you should be doing for cybersecurity. So what I'm showing you here is an overview of a potential product security program, showing you those unique things you need to be doing for product security at the different stages. Products aren't made overnight. They often spend years in R&D. So what you're doing for that product from a security perspective changes as the product's life cycle extends. And it starts all the way from the initial concept and feasibility all the way through to the point where you decide to end of life that product and you're no longer producing it or no longer supporting it. So what you'll notice when you're looking at that list, if you're a CISO or you're a CISO or you're familiar with those roles, you're going to look at a lot of the things on that list and say, well, yeah, that sounds really familiar to what a CISO or CISO does. And I'll acknowledge that at the high level, many of the responsibilities have the same name. But I'm also proposing that that's where it stops. The execution of those responsibilities is very different when you're talking about enterprise infrastructure versus a product. So product security is a separate domain of knowledge than enterprise security. So let's talk about an incident response, for example. Every CISO, every CISO absolutely has the responsibility of incident response, but their domain is incident response in an enterprise. The CPSO's responsibility is incident response as it pertains to your products. So say an incident report comes through from a customer. In this case, I'm gonna say that a customer's told you that they were doing some pen testing on their internal network, and their results found that your software product had some open ports, some undocumented ports that they found open. And they were able to craft some specific commands to those ports that were able to crash the application. As the chief product security officer, you quickly put on your hat to try and figure out whether or not you can recreate this situation. And it's not typically that simple, depending on how many products you have, how many versions you have, how configurable they are. It can be very difficult to recreate the environment that that customer had. And even once you recreate the problem, what you have to ask yourself is, yes, I've recreated this particular instance of it, but does the problem stop there? Yes, the customer found one problem in the system, but is that the only one? Is there actually an entire family of vulnerabilities that this customer just uncovered? So the testing has to go much further. It's a tremendous amount of work to work with the R&D teams. If you are able to recreate it and you know you actually have a full-blown cybersecurity vulnerability at this point, that's when a lot of the chaos kicks in. So you're gonna have to start working with your chief legal counsel to figure out things like what kind of contractual statements have you signed? I mentioned those specific clauses getting put into purchase agreements. So what kind of contractual obligations do you have to your current customers as far as patching goes? So I see things like customers now requiring a patch within 30 days or a patch within 7 days. So how many of those have you signed? What requirements do you have to the customers you currently have? What about contractual customer notification? This is another common one I see now, is people introducing into their contracts that even if you don't have a patch out in 30 days, you will tell me within 7 whether or not there's a vulnerability I need to be concerned about. because all of a sudden these timelines kick in. On top of that, you actually have to now fix the vulnerability. So you're working with your teams to write new code, build it, test it, and release it. Releasing in and of itself is complicated. Is that putting it on your website? Is it pushing patches out to the device? Is it sending USB sticks to your customers? Is it sending technicians on site for things that require hand updating? And then you have to have your legal team investigate any kind of a liability. Depending on what kind of industry you're in, maybe a pretty heavily regulated one, and you may now have some liability issues that you need to be concerned about. So you'll notice that while incident response is a common ownership between the two teams or between the CISO and a CPSO, the way it's executed is very differently. So let's talk through some examples. So hackers attack a casino's fish tank thermometer to obtain sensitive data. So this was an interesting one where hackers attacked a smart thermometer to exfiltrate from a casino their high roller database. So very valuable information that they were able to extract through a smart thermometer. Now imagine the incident response that that thermometer company had to go through, the liability that they had for having been the reason that that data was lost, the product incident response that they had to handle. Another one I like to talk about is Fazio Mechanical Services. So what a lot of people never really dug deep into the target breach to find out that the reason the target breach happened was actually the smart connected HVAC system that was had a remote management portal in it. That HVAC system was run and owned by Fazio Mechanical. So what people don't often think about is what was the damage to Fazio Mechanical because of this breach? Because they were, in fact, the source of the target breach. What kind of reputational damage did they suffer? I guarantee other customers were calling them asking, what should we be doing? Do you have a patch? Do you have a fix? If they don't have a valid product security officer sitting there with a good head on their shoulders, it probably got very chaotic very quickly and probably wasn't handled very well. I absolutely love this one. So German parents told to destroy Kayla dolls over hacking fears. So the Kayla doll was the first of its kind. It was a smart doll that had a Bluetooth connection to a phone. It used that Bluetooth connection so children could ask the doll questions, ask it to play a song, and the doll would use the phone to look that up and do it. The problem was very shortly after it was released, the entire country of Germany actually banned the doll because a cybersecurity vulnerability was found in the doll that allowed it to potentially be a remote monitoring device. The country of Germany literally labeled this device an espionage device and outlawed it. Now imagine this company spent a lot of money on R&D, and to have this happen shortly after this doll was released crippled their ability to recoup that R&D cost. So what does it take to actually be a chief product security officer? What makes a good one? The first and foremost is they have to have the tech skill set. Now, depending on the size of the company or the maturity of the company, that CPSO doesn't necessarily need to be down in the weeds. They don't necessarily need to be the one actually sitting next to the engineers saying that piece of code looks wrong. But if it's a larger company and they're going to run teams, at the very minimum, they need to be familiar with all of these, how they pertain to products, and when to use them, and more effectively, how to use the results. I often see heads of security execute these. They go through the motions. And then the results that come back from them aren't leveraged correctly, so they don't know how to actually learn from the information they're getting in. So how do you actually apply the results that come from these? The background, I laid the ground truth earlier that I really do think product security is different from enterprise security. And one of the key tenets of that is that it is very different to understand how product life cycles work, to understand how products go from an idea to a marketed product. So I do think a background in research and development, or just a knowledge in how product life cycles work, is critical. The evangelism piece. Cybersecurity always has usability trade-offs. Whether you're talking about the enterprise level or at the product level, there will always be usability trade-offs with security. So what that means is you need somebody who understands product security but can help manage that balance, help find cybersecurity solutions for your products that still make the product usable at the end of the day and will still make your customers happy. Spreading awareness and education is absolutely key, as it is with any security awareness training. People don't like security. If security is not a part of your day job, it's often seen as the roadblock to complete your day job. The same is true for product security. You would start to introduce to your engineering R&D teams roadblocks, things they have to do for security that if they don't understand why they're being asked to do them, they will resist them. At the end of the day, you're also just changing the status quo. The culture changer is critical here as well. People don't often think of the softer skills of people in the tech industry, but this is one where the culture changer actually requires really good soft skills. And it goes both upward and downward in sort of the hierarchy of a company. So on the downward side, the chief product security officer needs to be able to actually build a more secure product. They need to actually hit the road and build those product security programs and get the engineering teams on board with them and actually following them. But that's just the downward direction. The upward direction is you actually have to spend a tremendous amount of time convincing other leadership and other C-suite that product security matters. A true product security head is going to be spending a lot of time with your chief legal officer, your chief risk officer, your CISO, your CEO, because at the end of the day, product security actually does influence all of those areas. And if you as a CPSO can't tell that upward story, then you're also sort of doomed to fail because you're not going to have the support you need. So one thing I wanted to forget back here. The culture changer is also hard because I talked about you need the support. But why do you need the support? So you need the support because at the end of the day, cybersecurity, particularly in products, is always a monetary sink. It is always going to cost more money to design a more secure product. It is always going to take longer. At the end of the day, that support for money, for more time, for introducing more hurdles into a product roadmap, if you don't have the right support in the upward direction, you are going to become that person that everybody avoids in the hallway and is just seen as a no person. I've been the chief product security officer for a number of companies and built these programs, and I can tell you that if the culture's not right, people just hide from you. They don't invite you to the right meetings because you're seen as that roadblock. If you're seen as that roadblock, you're not going to have an effective product security program. So that's where all this ties together. That's where the evangelism piece comes in. That's where the education piece comes in. So one of the statements I'm also going to make is that I think the chief product security role should actually be at the C-suite level, not buried in R&D. So I also work with a tremendous number of heads of product security that are buried in R&D. These people are incredibly talented, they are doing great things, but I will tell you that their job is harder and they have a harder time making a more secure product because they are buried in R&D and not brought out at the corporate C-suite level. Some of that reason is the things I've talked about, right? It's always a monetary loss. You need to be able to coordinate with your chief risk officer, your chief legal officer, your CISO, the CEO. I'm proposing that the board should actually be briefed on product security as frequently as they are in enterprise security because of the business risk that the product security brings. So when it's buried inside of R&D, you often don't have that conduit. That head of product security who's five layers deep under R&D, they don't get time on the calendar of the chief legal officer. They don't get time on the calendar of the chief risk officer. And often, security is directly in conflict with the metrics that are set up for the head of R&D. So if you're the head of R&D, you probably have a profit and loss budget that you're trying to keep. You have timelines, you're incentivized to get products out the door in a timely manner and for as cheap as possible. You start to introduce things like product security, it's directly in conflict with that. I'm asking as the head of product security in R&D to add months to your timeline, to add non-trivial amounts of money to your budgets. That directly conflicts with the metrics that the R&D head is probably held to. So it's another kind of just stress point. where it is easier for a chief product security officer to do the right thing if the company is truly interested in making a more secure product if they are rolled out at that C-suite level. I'm also proposing that the CPSO can actually report to the CSO. So while I've made the argument that it's not the same thing as a CSO, and that the CSO traditionally should not actually be responsible or held accountable for product security because it's a different domain of knowledge, I actually do think it can work for the CPSO to roll up to them. So when that works is where the CSO recognizes that product security is a different domain. So just like situations where a CISO rolls up, CISO's domains are information security. They were brought in to augment the chief security officer. Chief product security officer's domain is product security. So in my mind, those two kind of sit on the same pedestal. They both have different domains of cybersecurity they're interested in or they're responsible for, and those two can roll up successfully to a chief security officer as long as that chief security officer understands that product security is different and it needs to be treated differently. So kind of the grand takeaways here, the chief product security officer is in fact a unique need at any product or any company that sells products. It's different from a CISO, it's different from a CISO. Right now, when you look at those types of roles in industry, traditionally, they all have network enterprise security backgrounds. I think we will get to a point one day where you find CSOs who do have more of a product security background, but we're not there right now because traditionally that wasn't the CISO's domain. So the CISOs you have out in the world right now have been focused on enterprise security, so that's what their expertise is in. The CPSO at the end of the day, they are controlling the business risk created by the cybersecurity in your products that you're selling. So as the takeaways of what you should do from here, immediately following this presentation, I want all of you to think about, for the companies you work for, think of the products that you sell. Think about their cybersecurity needs and their potential impact to your company. So really actually reflect on that. And then in the couple months following this, what you need to do is evaluate your company's products and your appetite for risk. Is it at an unacceptable risk level right now to not have a chief product security officer? Review your organizational structure to determine where it would be the best fit. I propose there's a couple different places that it can fit, and it depends on your organizational structure. And then actually bring in a CPSO. Leverage that CPSO to control that business risk of your products. And I don't have an ending slide, but that was it. Thanks. I'll leave it on that one. I guess questions, if anyone has questions. Yeah, someone's come up to Mike.
Hi, thanks for the presentation. I have a question that's sort of reversing what your talk was a little bit in I'm a CISO for a software company that does have products. And one of the things that we see increasingly is that our customers are very confused about the difference between enterprise security and product security. And so when they send us vendor risk assessments, they are asking questions that really don't make a lot of sense. And one of the things that we're struggling with is explaining that a lot of the questions that they have don't make sense in the context of what they're purchasing from us. Yeah. So I was curious to see what you think, sort of the flip side of this, how do you educate your customers on the difference between enterprise security and product security?
Oh, you bring up such a pain point, which is filling out those questionnaires. So having worked for various product companies, I can tell you that exactly what she's talking about absolutely happens. Every customer has a unique questionnaire that they send you that they want to hear about different features or cybersecurity features of your product. But what they fail to understand is that a lot of those questions are for enterprise IT questions. They'll be asking about certifications that are literally for network, enterprise networks. On devices, on products, and trying to explain to them that when I answer no, I don't have this certification, it's not because it's not relevant, is a real struggle. So I wish I had a silver bullet for that because I struggle with that a lot. What we're trying to do, my past couple years has been focused specifically in the healthcare space. So what we're trying to do in the healthcare space is get unified questionnaires that are adopted by the industry. So we're trying to get to the point where there is a single questionnaire that we've had enough stakeholders come together and make that we're trying to get everyone in the industry to use it because it actually has relevant questions. So that's just one industry's approach to trying to fix that problem. Is part of that is education. Part of it is also just, even if every single person's questionnaire only had relevant questions, at the end of the day, we have teams of people filling out these questionnaires, which is not a good use of a security person's time. So it solves other problems by having these unified questionnaires, but we'll see if it catches on. Any other questions you guys have for me? Yeah, go ahead.
Hi. I want to tie two thoughts together. The first thought was around legal, having to notify people of patches, et cetera, within 30 days or whatever, X amount of days, but also the question about people filling out questionnaires. So my question is, how do you prevent salespeople from signing up for things that you can't live to? What kind of controls and processes do you have in place for that?
Yeah, so signing up for stuff you can't actually deliver is not that uncommon. So I will say I've been in a number of situations where a big purchase contract comes in that has a requirement in there that we are unable to push back on. So we sign it and then we panic and get the things in place to make us able to do that. So particularly around things like customer notifications, a big one, where lately I've seen a lot of contracts around you will notify me in 30 days if there's a vulnerability, or you will notify me in 2 weeks if you become aware of a vulnerability. That process of customer notification in such a short timeline is really hard. So trying to get those procedures in place, get everything signed off by legal, it is not a small lift. But a lot of times the voice of the customer and that requirement to make a sale is actually the driving force we needed to get those procedures in place, because I can tell you those procedures to do 30-day notification would have never happened if that purchase contract hadn't come in and forced us to do it. So in a way, it kind of drove us in the right direction, but you know, we got there in a frenzy instead of proactively.
Hi, so an established company already does a lot of the things that you said the CPSO would do, right? Vulnerability management, risk analysis, that sort of thing. So how do you convince the board that a CPSO is, you know, someone that they should, you know, carve out a space for?
Yeah, so when you say they already do those things, do they already do them for their product or do they do them at the enterprise level?
Product. Well, they do both, but for product development, you know, they're going to have an established vulnerability management, you know, system in place. And
yeah, so I guess I would ask in that company then who owns all of that? I mean, who put all of that in place? If they have a great product security framework, that's awesome.
Yeah. It's dispersed, yeah. Right? So I guess the question is, you know, does it make sense to try to, you know, bring responsibility for that under one person, you know, and still leave it in a dispersed way? Or, you know, is it something that you should try to kind of consolidate in order to get consistency across products, that sort of thing?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a big fan of consolidating it, both for consistency and for actual ease of enacting any of those processes or procedures. You'll find when you're writing almost any of them, there is a need for somebody at the end of the day to either have sign-off or make a big decision, and having that person be kind of one unified person who is responsible for all of those, I actually think leads to a better security program instead of one person who can maybe sign off on this type of a process, one person who can sign off on this type of process. You get inconsistency across all your product lines, and it leads to a lot of redundant effort where these different various people who own pieces of the puzzle are probably doing a lot of the same job, and actually consolidating it would at the end of the day actually be more efficient.
Another follow-up question would be related to DevOps and DevSecOps, right? So there's, at least in my company, there's a big push for, hey, let's make everything agile and DevOps, DevSecOps. So that kind of argues against trying to do any sort of consolidation. But at the same time, what we notice is that a lot of the teams are immature in their DevOps or DevSecOps so that they're less likely to, you know, apply the rigor that you would want for security in that space. And What sort of guidance might you offer for that, for the CPSO?
Yeah, I mean, that's sort of where that unified and evangelistic culture changer comes in, is you've got these immature product teams, and at the end of the day, your product teams, they don't need to be experts in cybersecurity. They have to have faith that the person who is leading cybersecurity is leading them down the right path, and that the policies and procedures and the rules and the tools you're putting in place are actually going to, at the end of the day, help them. So that's kind of where that soft skills of that role comes in, is that ability to change culture and lead them in the right direction becomes so crucial, because you can take those immature teams and actually have them make good cybersecurity solutions just right out of the gate. In fact, those immature teams who aren't entrenched in a really complicated bureaucratic process, it's actually usually easier to fix those situations. There's not as much resistance.
Hello, Stephanie. Dean Campbell, Boston Scientific Cardiac Rhythm Management. We have had in our business a product security practice for quite some time. I know you're familiar with some of our staff. But the CPSO, as you've described it, is a newer concept to me. And perhaps, I don't know how extensively this is being adopted within the medical device industry or elsewhere. But just interested in your perspective on, you know, is this something that is companies are adopting to a greater extent? Our practice was, as you said, buried within R&D for many years. It has been elevated somewhat, not to the level that you described, but so interested in just kind of how you see this as having sprung up, if you will, and to what extent it's being adopted by other organizations, and if any success story. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, so we're definitely, and yeah, I'm familiar with you guys' product security program. You guys have a lot of great people. And we're on a maturity cycle here where many industries or many companies right now are really just starting to appreciate the fact that they even need a head of product security. And that natural evolution, that organic growth, is typically that head of product security starts in R&D. What I've seen, as a consultant who works with a lot of companies, what I've seen is that organic growth, while it typically starts in R&D, what they find is that over time, to make that position successful, it needs to roll out from R&D and roll up at that corporate level. That doesn't mean it can't work inside of R&D. Sometimes it just comes down to the culture of the company. If the company absolutely appreciates cybersecurity and that person doesn't need to constantly fight, then it can work, right? But that natural evolution, that organic growth, is typically that it does start in R&D, and then over time, as the position matures, it kind of rolls out to the point where it needs to be that kind of global overarching position to have purview into it. So I see a lot, I see everything along that maturity life cycle, so I still see a lot of it being in R&D, and I still salute the fact that at least they have a head of product security. 5 years ago, I didn't even see those. So it's starting in R&D, I don't think is a bad step. It is better than having no head of product security, and I've seen those programs drive good changes in products. But sort of what I'm proposing is that I have seen on that maturity life cycle that they tend to almost always roll out from R&D as the framework gets more mature and they're trying to still refine and get better at what they're doing, it almost always rolls out from R&D.
Thank you.
Welcome. Any other questions?
Continuation of that, what gets left behind in R&D? You know, we have a lot of apps and programs, and I certainly see the need at the C-suite level, but you know, maybe a little bit about what kind of organization underneath.
Sure.
CPSO?
Yeah, so while I'm proposing that the CPSO should actually be not in R&D, what you will still commonly see is there are still representatives in the R&D team. So you will see, depending on the number of products, the number of business lines, number of families, you may have one security engineer who they technically roll up to the CPSO, but they're embedded in those development teams. So security is not typically a full-time thing that they need to be on a product team, so you'll see a security engineer be assigned to maybe be on like 3 or 4 products at the same time, or one particular family of products. So you will still see an absolute influence in people in embedded in the R&D teams. It has to be successful. But those people will typically then roll up to that corporate level. But that corporate level, they still need, you know, you need the tendrils that are down in R&D, because at the end of the day, that more secure product, it has to happen at the R&D level. Does that kind of address your question? Yeah. Usually, I mean, directly in some fashion, depending on the size. I mean, there are some teams that are, you know, 30 or 40 product security engineers, so you'll have layers. But I tend to see them still roll up. So at the end of the day, their responsibility is to product security, and they are representatives that are kind of embedded in those project teams. Okay. Yeah. They recorded it.
I'm with GE Digital, and actually on the services and project side, we struggle with where different security tasks should fall, because we are a vendor company, and of course we're developing products and so on. So what you're saying is resonates to me. My question to you is that in the development life cycle, there are certain suites of tools that we use in the product development lifecycle. Would you see those falling under the CPSO realm, or should those be maintained by IT? In my own organization, we're kind of waffling between whether they existed in research and development division, or whether they should be handed over to to IT to maintain, or whether they should be part of the project. And the second question I have for you is, do you see the CPSO's role as also overseeing security on projects? Because it's not enough to just build security into the product. Mm-hmm. How you build it and the project control, the security controls on the project also, have a bearing on whether the product you end up with is secure.
Yeah, so to address your first one, from the tool perspective, if the tool is specifically only for product security, so say it's a like a source code auditing tool, IT has no need to use such a tool. So you would typically see the ownership of that or the purchase decision made for that under the CPSO. Now, as far as licensing management, you will see in a lot of companies just centralized licensing management for every tool roll up under IT. So from the license management perspective, if IT is accustomed to managing all software licenses in the corporation, that's fine. But the ownership of doing the vendor assessments, picking the tool of what's best useful to those product teams should roll up to the CPSO for things like that where it is product specific. You'll see gray areas where there's overlap. So things like vulnerability scanners, your IT team absolutely has those, and your product security team should also be leveraging those on the product. So those ones sit in a gray area where probably they're owned by IT, but that's where that kind of relationship of also being at that higher level, that the CPSO is absolutely coordinating with the CISO and the CISO. So you're going to have kind of a gray area where some of those tools can be used in both regards, and probably traditionally they're owned by the enterprise security team, but you're going to leverage them on your product security team. So vulnerability scanners are a great example of that. I forget the second question.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think that absolutely falls under the same domain as that chief product security officer. So I had on there just generically things like policies and procedures and kind of the whole quality of the whole endeavor. All of that leads to a more secure product. So that's sort of where my tenet of it's not a feature we can bolt on. It's the emergent property of a well-designed system, and part of that is also your project controls. And how are you actually controlling the project at a higher level? If it's chaos and there's no control there and there's no thought for cybersecurity, you're also not going to get a very secure system. So I think it all kind of bleeds together.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions?
Yeah. There's not so much a question, but more like just comments. So
sure.
I don't serve as a chief product security officer. We call it just product hardening. And what we do is we actually roll in licensing and product hardening underneath me. And for as it affects or trying to influence engineering. I used to report into commerce, but in order to sell the role as we're going to save the company money, blah, blah, blah. But then now I'm rolling into engineering because we can now create a framework for all engineers to follow so that the product security can then be blended into all the other products. So just not really a question, but this is how we do it.
Yeah, and it doesn't mean it can't be successful, and also some of it depends on the size of the company, the maturity of the company. I mean, in smaller companies where it's a relatively flat org chart, also rolling into R&D is maybe one person different from not rolling on into R&D. So it also can depend on the size of the company, but as you get to larger companies, that's where you just tend to see it roll out. But again, it doesn't mean it can't be successful. If you have the right culture in place and you have the right evangelism, it can still be successful under R&D. Any other questions? Awesome. All right. Well, thanks. Oh, wait. Question. Sorry.
I just wanted to ask, have you seen the CPSO role also taking responsibility for things, you know, after the product has been built? So technical support, professional services, training sales to not sell something that you don't do, working with partners?
Yeah. So that's part of that other peripheral stuff that I kind of lumped together as to why also it shouldn't be buried in R&D, because R&D is, you're helping influence in making a better product, but at the end of the day, I talked about, you're gonna have to be talking to legal, you're gonna have to work with marketing, you're gonna have to work with sales, you're gonna have to talk to your risk officer, because it's so much more than actually just designing a more secure product. You have to figure out, you know, what can you sign up from a liability perspective? What can your salespeople say? What can your marketing people say? So I can't put a percentage on it, but it's actually only maybe like 60% of a CPSO's job is actually the tech part of it. There's so much more than actually just designing a more technically secure product. And you bring up a fantastic point. It's working with sales, it's working with marketing. And one of the things I showed on that product security roadmap was really early on gathering customer needs. So you need your marketing and your salespeople to be out there asking customers what they want from a cybersecurity perspective. They're used to trying to figure out what features, what whiz-bang doodle buttons they want, but they're not used to asking, you know, what certifications would you like to see on the product? What kind of access control? Would you like it if we integrated with your current security solutions, or would you rather us implement our own? What solutions are you using? That kind of stuff, those sales and marketing people, they need to be gathering that for you to inform what you should be doing. So they also need to know that that's something they should be asking about, and it helps if they understand what they're asking. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, for sure. So no, great point. Okay, now there are no more questions. All right, awesome. Feel free to reach out anytime. Hit me up on LinkedIn. I love talking about this. Thank you, guys.